The activist generation of today is not something that I worry about because I see them very often just devouring themselves alive. It's the Dennis Prager show. I listen to people of all perspectives. I listen to Dennis Prager. He's a traditional conservative. I listen to Larry Sharp, who's not a media figure, but he's a politician who's a libertarian. I listen to Jordan Sheridan, who's a very left-wing person, Glenn Greenwald, H.A. Goodman, all very progressive people. And of course, sometimes people in the mainstream media, but not very often. And I'm convinced, and I'll show you a few examples, that the left activist movement poses so little threat in most cases that I don't think that they're going to really cause any change for you. At least in our generation, they're basically devouring themselves alive. They're like a fungus. They grow on a host, and at a certain point, they metastasize to such a point where they can no longer be sustained. The host doesn't give them enough sustenance anymore, and they're using too much energy, and they literally can't sustain themselves, and they basically rot and die. That's a left organization, and many people will ask, well, what about all these groups like Freedom Road or the Revolutionary Communist Party, or the Nation of Islam isn't necessarily a left group. How come they haven't withered and died? I'm not expecting them to ever disappear. I'm just saying that the belief that they're going to one day become the real leaders of America is very, very sensationalist. Now, one of the problems is that they do have a disproportionate amount of influence within our educational system. Okay, I'm not saying that they dominate it, because in reality, the establishment left dominates our educational system, but the establishment left is devoid of any ideas. So whenever they have to bring in ideas, whenever they have to promote new programming, where do they take it from? The far left. That's why so many people are homeschooling their kids nowadays. That's why so many people are turning to alternative schooling, whether it's private schools, parochial schools, charter schools, because they're tired of the bullshit. It doesn't really lead to any change. And it actually, it raises a generation of kids that really have no life skills. If you really want to educate your kids, forget about the fucking politics. You tell them, you know, you're going to be a damn carpenter, or let's say you own a small business, you make them work for you, and I guarantee you they'll do whatever the hell they want, they can do to get out of your mitts. They're gonna try anything they can to become independent financially from you if you do that. The approach where people let the school raise their kids is the failure that's led to where we are today. Now, let's talk about our topic at hand. The retard left, the regressive left, as some more politely describe them. I call them the retard left because if you look at the real definition of retarded, it means growth that's been inhibited by an external factor often. Okay, it doesn't necessarily have anything to do with mental disabilities. It has to do with inhibited growth. And what inhibits their growth? It's their idiotic clinging to doctrines that nobody really believes in and that nobody's ever going to benefit from. And one of the shows that I watch is they're very intelligent in certain ways because they do tell the truth. They do reject a lot of the tropes that are presented to especially to the black community, primarily to the black community. It's called Yvette Carnell's Breaking Brown. I don't know if the program is called Breaking Brown, but basically, she has a live stream. She has a person on her stream called Irami Osei-Frimpong. I think I'm pronouncing his name right. And he's a nice guy. And he's got he's got his own independent take. But then I started watching his a lot of his posts on social media. And this is a person that he literally thinks that the first priority ever should be reparations for black people as opposed to the general democratic socialist platform. Now, let me tell you something. I don't support either of those. So maybe he's right. He doesn't have to look for my vote. He doesn't have to look for my support, because I'm not going to support either of those things. I don't support reparations in general. I think it was a mistake of the Germans to give reparations to Israel and the Jews. I think that the best thing that they could have done was to form a partnership, some sort of a commercial partnership, where they would form businesses in Israel. They could give loans or something like that. But reparations, and I'm speaking purely out of real pragmatic realism. Okay, pragmatic realism. Sorry for the real pragmatic realism, but I'm speaking out of real practicality. What you need to do with reparations is always to look for closure. Okay, you don't pay reparations just so that they'll be thrown back at you in perpetuity, whatever crime that you committed or whatever damages you caused. The purpose of reparations, if you look at the word, is to repair damages done. And if the entire agreement fails to do that, if you still have grievances being brought up years and years later over reparations, then the actual enterprise serves no purpose. The only purpose it serves is for the receiver of the reparations to get enriched and get money in their pockets. Now that's fine for them, more power to them. If you want money and you can find a way to get it, I don't care. Go ahead and give it a try. If people want to independently donate money to you and you're willing to just take it, then, I mean, what am I supposed to say? If the person's dumb enough to just give you money, then good for you. You just found a sucker. Okay, that's really the long and short of it. I'm not going to judge you for it. I'm just saying those people are retarded. I'm saying that they're dumb. And this whole idea that people are historically obligated to give you money for something that a person who died 150 years ago suffered from, that's probably one of the more ridiculous things I've ever heard. You might as well say to me that because your grandpa got shot by the mob, that the mob should pay you money, okay? Nobody owes you money for something that happened to somebody else, okay? Nobody owes you money for that. And in a certain karmic way, if you believe in, things that like I said, karmic justice, okay, then you could say that they have what's coming to them. Okay, but if you think that for everything that happened to your ancestors, you deserve something financially from somebody else, then I'd like to see where it says that. I'd like to see exactly how you think that's going to solve anything. And I'd like to know if you really think you're going to forgive somebody who you don't know for doing something to somebody that you don't know either. Remember, a lot of these people don't even know who their ancestors are. A lot of these people who are demanding reparations actually have more white ancestors than they do black ancestors. Or they might have ancestors that aren't white or black. There's a substantial amount of black Americans that are the descendants of both black, white, Asian, and American Indian ancestors. Now, that's already a topic that they're debating heavily, and that's one of the reasons that the reparations movement is so ridiculously predicated on nonsense. First of all, the descendants of slaves, let's think about that. How many slaves were there in America in 1865? Now, let me look at this website. It's not easy to answer that question. First of all, there's disputes, but what the Black Agenda Report, I think Glenn Ford is affiliated with them, but this is written by Dennis Raincourt. I don't hate these people. They're fine. I don't care. They can hate me, and I don't care. Because in the end, if you hate me, then I know where you stand. Okay? If you hate me, then we know what the score is. That's my attitude. So he takes it this way, okay? He takes 70 years, 1790 to 1860. Why 1790? That was the year that the Constitution was ratified by all 13 states. The 13 colonies became officially the 13 states of the United States of America under the Constitution. And then he multiplies that by an average number of 2 million slaves for that period times 365 days a year. times 10 hours of work a day at a minimum, times 725 per hour, that's minimum wage, equals 3.7 trillion bucks. Then he says, next I apply the 2% interest rate compounded annually. This gives a multiplicative factor of 1.02 to the 140th, which equals 16 for the 140 years from 1860 to 2000. Further compounding could be applied to bring us to the present. Again, this is a minimum estimate. Compounding to 2000 therefore gives $3.7 trillion times 16, which is $59.2 trillion. The latter one-time payment would be easy for the USA to make since its annual GDP is $15 trillion. Think of a wealthy person's annual salary relative to buying a house in a safe neighborhood. The USA would not even need to sell any assets to achieve this modest payment. For the 40 million black slave descendants in the US today, the calculated reparation means that US white society owes each and every black slave descendant a minimum payment of $1.5 million, which is long overdue. After the minimum payment is made, it would be appropriate to calculate and pay the additional reparations that are due. My goal here was to show that these calculations are simple and unambiguous. Understanding the calculated minimum allows one to move forward from that established basis towards a more realistic reparation number. At the very least, each black slave descendant can legitimately demand $1.5 million payable immediately. An obvious question that arises from this straightforward calculation is, why are black leaders not demanding reparation as a priority demand? Well, the answer to that is that people know that Americans don't care about justice. And I don't care about justice, because in this case, this is not about justice. This is about revenge. This is about, it's both revenge and opportunism. And I don't care about either, whether it's revenge or if it's social justice, as they like to call it. I'm not going to pay for it, and you know it. And if you ever try to do something like this and get it passed, I'm just going to cheat on my taxes. And most Americans will, because we don't give a fuck. First of all, a lot of black Americans should understand, just because your ancestors suffered, it doesn't mean that we really have to care about you if you're being an asshole to me. My ancestors didn't come here until the 1980s. Okay, so I don't really feel any guilt towards you on the part of white America. I also happen to have read a little about how the Civil War happened. And one of the things that happened was that white Americans in the North, and in fact, a lot of slave owners in the South, did a lot of work to end the institution of slavery. The first thing that they were doing was the Underground Railroad. Could the Underground Railroad have really succeeded without the help of white people? You know, it doesn't matter what their real motives are. Some of them could have been assholes, but could have succeeded without the help of white Americans, you know, the Quakers. A lot of these people, like I think his name was John Brown, the Harper's Ferry dude. No, the short answer is no. A lot of these black people that became activists, Sojourner Truth and Frederick Douglass, yes, they had to go through a lot, and we should never take away from them, and from them only, that they did something that none of us today will ever be asked to do, and that's to really fight for their basic right for freedom. Okay, what is wrong is to claim that they were the only people who fought against the institution of slavery. Here, hold on a second. So a lot of people talk about the suffering of the slaves during the slavery, and that's something that we should never, ever minimize. But you should also remember that in order to end slavery, Americans as a whole paid a huge price. And the majority of Americans at the time were white Americans. A lot of slaves, freed slaves, you know, these blacks who fought in the Union Army, they also died. It says here, 110,000 Union troops died, killed in action, or died of wounds in the Civil War. 94,000 Confederates died. Okay, that's not a small price, especially in the United States, which at the time there was an army of 2,200,000 in the North, and only about 750,000 to 1 million in the South. Okay, 94,000 is more than one in every eighth people. So could you imagine one in every eight in your group of friends died? That just died. There were 230,000. Okay, let's not forget that. 230,000 plus died due to non-combat related deaths, including disease or other accidents. You know, there could be boat capsizings and things like that in the Navy or you know, various other. This wasn't like an OSHA-approved workspace, so you have to remember people died all the time being in the Army. It wasn't like the Army now where you get to like drop by the PX and buy a camera or something. There was none of that. You were basically treated like shit, especially if you were Irish. 25 to 30,000 died in Confederate prisons. On the Confederate side, 26 to 31,000 died in Union prisons. And there was a total of 365,000 dead on the Union side, 282,000 wounded, 181,000 captured. So those people that don't go and act like, oh, we suffered and nobody else actually cared about it. Well, somebody did something to end it. Okay, you should never dispute that. Okay, now the fact is that America had no altruistic motive for any of this. One of the reasons that we fought the Civil War was in order that our government would assume total power over the South, that there would be none of this secession nonsense and whatever. That's unrelated to the question of slavery. It's almost as if America was fighting this war in order to solidify its authority. So slavery was one of the excuses to fight this war. And that's where I come and say to you, your whole question of justice has never been, your whole priority of justice has never been a priority for anyone who's actually done anything important. You can go throughout history, and altruism is almost as, it's almost like trying to find a needle in a haystack in history, for events like this. You know, ending slavery, fighting a civil war. Do you think they fight civil wars so that they can have ponies and ice cream and you know, chipwiches? No, that's not how it works. So the reparations crowd, I'll tell you another thing that they forget. One of the things that people think about the U.S. Congress and about the U.S. government is that the issue of reparations has never come up. Although it did, they do acknowledge their, I mean, it's part of their whole thing. The 40 acres and a mule thing, that, you know what, if they promise that to you guys, then okay, let's give you 40 acres and a mule. I'm fine with that. I don't know what you're going to do with a mule. But look, there's this congressman, John Conyers of Michigan. The guy's a million years old. He was born in 1929, and he's been in Congress since, holy shit. Okay, here we go. 1965. This guy was in the Korean War, I think. And he's gone and basically racialized everything that could possibly be racialized. And he's married to this woman, Monica Conyers, who's also a city council member. And she's been convicted of bribery. Okay, and this guy is this, you know, he's proposed several times these reparations bills. Here, let me find them. I have one that I found a little earlier. Hold on. There's another issue that he had an ethics controversy where he had aides work for him, basically for you know, peanuts, to chauffeur his kids and babysit them and whatever. That's, for example, that's what you have. Those are the type of people who advocate for reparations in Congress. Okay, but I couldn't find a broader record. I think he's introduced a ton of bills on this, but if you want a specific one, and I'll post the link, it says all bill information except text. For House of Representatives 40, Commission to Study Reparations Proposals for African Americans Act. And basically all it did was, and it was introduced and never voted on because nobody's going to vote for such a waste of money. First of all, you can do this research independently, okay? And if you want to do that research and present it to Congress and have this, basically this Yoda, John Conyers, listen to you about why you're owed money, then go ahead and do it. But I don't think that we've covered any new ground in the past 80 years on why America had a bad relationship with our indentured slaves, or rather our chattel slaves. What is true, though, is that, first of all, Americans are not going to vote for reparations. We're not a country that responds well to, we're just going to pay money to people we don't know. We're going to pay money for things that happen to people that have been dead for generations, to people that they claim descent from them, but they actually had nothing happen to them, and they're actually living in a country that treats them completely differently from the way they were treated during slavery. One of the other ideas that he floated, the same guy, Irami, was that blacks be given permanent jobs in the federal government. That might be one of the dumbest ideas ever, because once you give people guaranteed employment with no consequences and absolutely no accountability, then the service just goes to shit. It's happened in every country where they've tried it. It happens in Cuba, for example. If you have guaranteed employment, what's the reason for anybody to actually try? What's the reason for the services to succeed? Are you depending on people's altruism? I hope that you're not depending on people's altruism, because if you go outside, you'll probably find that you're not finding it right now, and they're not likely to change, okay? There's nothing that you're saying right now that's going to make people act like better than they have until now. Another example, which is unrelated to this discussion, is this feminist bookstore that I happened to pick this up while looking at the other argument. There was another poster that he claimed that he was working at this bookstore that's actually a fictional bookstore. So he got me, and I acknowledge that. But it's called the Women and Women First Bookstore, and it's on this little show called Portlandia, which is a show about how dumb and retarded Portland is and how little, how detached from reality its residents are. These people that, you know, it's basically a hipster haven in Portland, where virtue signaling is almost more important than knowing when to cross the street when the crosswalk is lit. The show was using this actual commie lesbian feminist store as a scene location, and the real store is called In Other Words. And after a few years, the problem with that bookstore is that it's not a real business. It's really a co-op that is managed by a bunch of loser feminists that have never succeeded at anything in their lives, and they're not trying to succeed because all they want to do is blame somebody for the reason why they're failures. So it's a circular process, okay? Step one, realize that you're a failure at everything you do and that you have no talent. Step two, that was a fail on my part. I put up three fingers when I wanted two. Now I acknowledge that was my failure. Step two, blame that failure on people that have absolutely nothing to do with you and that could care less about what you say. That way you can be sure that they'll never do anything to actually help you, because you really don't want to be helped. You just want to complain more and get things for free. Step three, open an enterprise that is actually not profitable and destined for failure and doesn't have a sustainable model. That would be the bookstore. Step four, run the bookstore as if it's something that people owe the owners to patronize, but when they come in, you actually treat them with zero respect, and you basically scare away your customers, thereby leading to step five, the business fails and the management turns over, hence sending you back to step one, realizing that you're a fucking failure. That is how a feminist bookstore works, and I'll read you this NPR story. You know, NPR, finally, they give a story that is actually entertaining. And it says, Feminist bookstore slams Portlandia and says show can no longer film there. That's from September 30th, 2016. I don't know how I missed that. It must have been some sort of like crazy election going on. You know, these people had nothing better to do than cut ties with a show that was one of their main revenue streams. So they said, fuck Portlandia. So it says in the TV comedy version of Portland, Oregon, the bookstore is called Women and Women First. In real life, it's in other words. And the shop is used in frank terms to say that Portlandia's show is no longer welcome to film there. The feminist store and community center faults the show's depiction of men dressing as women, its treatment of store staff, and its role in gentrification and race relations. The staff of In Other Women made those claims in a blog post that shares its title with a sign that was placed in its window when the store's relationship with the show soured. The title is straightforward. Fuck Portlandia. The store staff that says that by featuring Portlandia co-star Fred Armisen in a wig and a dress as Candace, one of the owners of Women and Women First, the show throws trans femmes under the bus by holding up their gender presentation for mockery and ridicule. Well, they just made me, because this is one of the funniest shows. This really shows that feminists are fucking retards and they can't have a sense of humor about anything. That's one of the funniest skits I've seen on that show. They do a lot of funny shit. It's a show that liberals and conservatives should be able to laugh at equally. On TV, the bookstore is portrayed as a home for strident advocacy and outrage. In its blog post, the staff of In Other Words depicts the IFC comedy as diametrically opposed to our politics and the vision of society we're organizing to realize. We've asked the folks at IFC for their reaction and we'll update this post when they respond. The tone of the store's blog is markedly different from 2012, when the comedian and Portlandia regular Kumail Nanjiani visited In Other Words and spoke to some of its board members for a short online video. Asked whether they'd seen the feminist bookstore sketch, one board member, who wasn't identified by name in the video, said, "It's not like a lot of what happens here, but it's funny." See, back in 2011, did it say 2011? 2012. Some of these people had a sense of humor. Apparently, in the past 4 years, suddenly what's funny became a little more serious on a show that's never been about taking things seriously. When Angie Annie asked about Armisen dressing as a woman for the sketches, a board member replied, "That's called gender expression. In Other Words, it's a volunteer-run community center," according to its Facebook page. So if it's a community center, maybe the book should be for free. The store says that none of its current board and staff members were involved in the original decision to allow Portlandia to film inside the store 6 years ago, and that the small flat fee per episode film doesn't cover its lost profits. Maybe you should have asked for more money, bitch. From its blog post, it says, "The additional exposure we have received from our time on Portlandia does not provide financial or political support of any kind. Tourists and fans of the show come to our door to stand outside, take selfies, and then leave. The vast majority of them don't come inside. Maybe you should have a sale or something. Maybe you should maybe sell books that people want to read instead of crap that almost nobody wants to read. You know, talk about things that have actual demand in the market." The store also says it has undergone changes in the past 2 years, saying that it now hosts meetings of Portland's Black Lives Matter group. And that the last time the show filmed in our space, the production crew asked us to remove the Black Lives Matter signs on our window. We refused. I doubt that really happened, by the way. I think that I know enough about the show and its creators to think they wouldn't have given a fuck what would have been on the show. At most, they probably would have asked to move it from a certain scene because it clashed with something else they wanted to put up. But I doubt that really happened. In fact, I believe they lied. They probably lied about that. I actually trust the integrity of those two comedians, Carrie Brownstein and Fred Armisen, more than these feminist Fruit Loops. In another passage, the store staff accuses Portlandia of essentially rolling out a red carpet of twee and whimsy for the incoming technocrat hordes. The bookstore says it first displayed the Fuck Portlandia sign several months ago when its board and staff initially decided to cut ties with the show. The store's blog post seems to have been prompted by local alternative weekly Willamette Week's attempts to ask questions about the sign. On the paper's story about that interaction, which didn't go well, a reader commented, "How can you be sure this isn't just part of another episode of Portlandia?" That would have been a great episode. I haven't seen that show for a while. This might, you know what? This story might actually make me go back and watch more Portlandia, because I remember how funny that show was, especially this scene. In other words, is located in a northeast Portland district called Albina, an area that has a rich history as a home for the city's black residents. Now, this is where it gets even funnier. Already, they're saying, fuck Portlandia, a show that probably gave them the most amount of revenue of anything else they have done. So they've already stabbed their main revenue streamers in the back. Now, watch what happens when they try to attract help from people that should nominally support them, and we see what the left really does to other people on the left. Responding to the store's accusation that Portlandia contributes to gentrification and depicts an overly white Portland, at least two readers took the store to task. Quote, unquote, are you serious? Your store itself is the epitome of gentrification to the actual displaced residents of Northeast Portland. A reader named Xavier Woods wrote in a comment on the store's blog post. Another person said, this is 150% valid. Or no, the store responds, this is 150% valid. The store wrote in response, sorry doesn't mean a thing when people are still actively being displaced, but we are sorry. And we are working every day to make sure we are a contribution to the neighborhood and that we are doing everything we can to build the power of the neighborhood. The store concluded its blog post by asking any readers that support its stance to donate or volunteer. So what you have here is this store full of dumb menstrual or menopausal bitches that they've decided, you know what, you know, we're tired of getting, you know, name recognition or, well, not name recognition, but at least scene recognition from a popular show that many people of like-minded belief watch and enjoy and, you know, actually you know, they take time out of their day to watch, and it involves their own store. They're tired of it. It's a burden to them. So they say, fuck that show. We're going to, that show doesn't agree with our values now, although 4 years ago it did. 4 years ago, we were all fine with taking money from a show that's on the independent film channel, fronted by these two goofy comedians. But now, not so much, because they're transphobic or something, and, you know, they contribute to a lot of the, you know, they basically threw Portlandia under the bus. One of the best shows that anybody could actually watch regarding Portland. Especially Portland, but you know what I'm saying, that they basically stabbed their own people in the back. They could have just taken more money, you know, but they decided to stab themselves in the chest with their own flag. Then they put up a blog post explaining it, and their leftist allies call them out for being gentrifiers. And gentrifiers, what's the objection to gentrifiers? People are upset that people are coming in and investing in neighborhoods and businesses in neighborhoods and bringing the rents up through improving the value of the neighborhood. So they call that racist. So the bookstore is attacking Portlandia for helping them by giving them business through selling scenes. You know, if they weren't satisfied with the amount of money they were getting for the filming, they should have just asked for a lot more, since Portlandia makes money. Then they publicize it, and they get attacked by the area residents who they're trying to help for bringing the neighborhood up. So that's the way the left, you can't win with the left. It's all about losing. If you win, you lose. If you lose, you win. That's the way it works. And I'm sorry, you Uhuru people and the Black Hitler people, that's the people that Irami was, Irami, I think his name is, Irami. Those are the people you support. Those people are fucking losers. And I bet when they lose in that election, they'll probably get, there's an election that he's promoting in St. Petersburg, Florida, I think, where one of their candidates, Jesse Neville, I'll put his link up, he's running for mayor on a reparations slate. I'll bet you that he makes less of an impact than that DeRay McKesson did in Baltimore. That guy got 3% in the Democratic primary, okay, which is pretty much the election. So I bet that this Jesse Neville, he'll probably lose to somebody who you know, is some sort of, maybe some dude that runs around in a panda suit or something. That's how bad he'll do, because nobody wants this, and none of your moralistic crap is going to change anybody's mind. I don't owe you anything. I don't know you, and you probably don't like me anyway, which would make it mutual, okay? Because if you're coming and always asking for stuff and claiming that you deserve it, even though nothing actually happened to you, it happened to somebody that you're related to that you've never met in your life, I'm just going to say, well, I'm not going to pay, and even if you try to make me to pay, I'll try to everything I can to avoid paying it. So that's the end. I hope you guys have a great Sunday. Maybe there'll be another video later. Have a great week. And this is Ramon with Bold Like a Leopard. Bold Like a Leopard on Facebook. Bold Like a Leopard on YouTube. Chef Leopard on Twitter. And there's also on Blogspot, strutting leopard.blogspot.com. And have a great week. And we'll see you around the bend.